All right, three, two, one.
Welcome, everybody, to the side quest for January 15th. I'm like, I was super quiet. I'm like, hey, everybody, how's it? Side quest! Hey, it's January 15th in 2017, the year of Luigi plus three.
The year of our Lord Luigi. What's a thing, huh?
Yeah, the year of our Lord Luigi plus three. Welcome to the side quest, your bi-weekly, right? Or bi-month, what, how is it? Bi-weekly, bi-monthly, I don't even know. But twice a month-ish, maybe more, maybe less, depends on our schedules. Video game podcast for the very popular website, sidequesting.com. I am Dolly Domovsky, joining you on this post-Switch holiday weekend. Also joining me is the very lovely Tom Johnson.
What's up, guys?
God, so motherfucking beautiful. The wonderfully attractive Sam Dixon.
Hello, friends.
Yay! Good to see you. And the incredibly dashing Wout, the hashtagonist.
Yeah. And I'm like peak Sunday. I'm like wearing sweatpants and an old t-shirt. Like...
That is peak Sunday evening. We have a holiday tomorrow here in the States, so it's a... I'm not wearing pants right now. I'm just had to put a t-shirt on. But how you guys doing? Everybody having a nice weekend?
Good.
Oh yeah, always.
Good. So we have a great show for everybody today. We're going to talk about the Nintendo Switch reveal, news, all that fun stuff, and then get into some of our favorite games of the year for those of you that have been visiting the wonderful website of sidequesting.com. You'll have seen that we've begun posting our favorite games of the year. So always worth checking back with us and seeing what our editors like, and we go from there. So, but we're gonna start with the Nintendo Switch because that was the big news this week on the 12th of January. Nintendo finally revealed all the launch details, everything you would need to know about the Nintendo Switch, from price, launch date, to online structure, what they're doing with Virtual Console, all the massive lineup that they're going to have for launch. And no, they didn't reveal everything, unfortunately. And there are a lot of unknowns right now, but let's get into it. First and foremost, March 3rd. Of 2017, our year, our Lord's year, Luigi plus three. And I'm going to keep saying, was it 2014 or 2015 year, Luigi? I can't remember.
Well, I say 2014.
All right. It's going to retail for $299.99. So first things first, price-wise, the date is earlier than I think anybody expected. We were all thinking.
Yeah, I was expecting the 17th.
The 17th or the 21st, 24th that weekend. So the 3rd, wasn't expecting it that early, but... they need to sell 2 million of these things to meet their goals for the quarter, right? Their fiscal quarter.
The 3rd is good, though, because now I get to play it for a good 2.5-3 weeks before Mass Effect comes out and I forget it exists.
Well, that's the thing. I think that's fantastic on the 3rd for that same reason. It's like they had to get out of Mass Effect's way. And there is actually kind of a lull during that week for games, which is, you know, it's pretty good. Then you get kind of the spring games, the end of Q1, beginning of Q2 games start to pick up. So... $299 price point. What are your gentlemen's thoughts on that?
I think it's a little like
in
slightly
Canada,
higher.
It's still like $500.
Holy What's that? Shit! Really?
For you guys?
Yeah. In Canada, it's like $399. That's exclusive of tax, so it's almost $500 if you pick up like four.
Holy shit!
Wow. Is that typical of game consoles?
Yeah, it's basically just your conversion rate there. It's not that more to worry.
How much is a PS4 right now in Japan?
$399.
Probably about 400,000 yen.
Yeah,
probably pretty similar then, right?
Yeah, yeah. It's just your conversion. It sounds a lot more expensive.
Yeah, right. I mean, I've gone to Canada on many occasions to buy shirts. So that's
all. Oh, yeah.
Toronto was Toronto was my home for several summers for clothing shopping. Yeah, that's okay. And it's very similar with our friends down in New Zealand and Australia who are really. A short, you know, when it comes to pricing, things are pretty exorbitant over there. Even though they're closer to Japan, they're way more expensive.
Conversion rate, like right now?
It's, it's probably like $700, right? For
No, it's 76 cents the dollar. Wow, I'm surprised.
Yeah, something crazy like that. So,
oh, sorry, $1 to 76 cents. Yeah.
Yeah,
that's not bad for me.
Yeah, that's true. So $2.99, is that too expensive? Is that, you know, is it right in line with what you're thinking?
It's not bundled in with anything, eh?
Sorry, why don't you go first? I should have said, hey, why don't you?
No, I'm just, look, that's bare bones. There's no game, no nothing. That is just the console, right?
Yes, it's just a console with with two Joy-Cons and the dock, all that kind of stuff. No games that we know of that they've, yeah.
I know, Tom. You were saying
I was expecting between 250 and 300. I thought 300 was going to be the ceiling, but man, I wasn't expecting them to be like, yeah, 300 for sure. I was more leaning towards 250. I still think 300 isn't like insane, right. But I was expecting it to be less.
I was between 249 and 299. In fact, I did an informal poll online and everybody chose either 249 or 299. I think 249 was the hopeful for most people because it just seems like, this holiday season we saw bare bones prices on PS4 and Xbox Ones. We saw Xbox Ones going for $179, the Xbox One S, at one point during the holiday season. So it is like this strange race to the bottom for hardware right now because they want to get more hardware in people's hands. So, I was expecting between $249 and $299. I'm not offended or upset at all at that $299 price. I think keep it under $300 and you're fine. And when you look at I think somebody posted a inflation rate for console launches and the Switch is like the third cheapest.
Third or fourth cheapest console. All of them are Nintendo consoles.
Again, I think it's because the price of the PS4 and the Xbox One S, which are 3-4 year old consoles now, has dropped considerably.
And it'll look way cheaper when Scorpio comes out.
Oh my God! Yeah, we want to get into Scorpio, which is gonna be like a $700, $800 system. People say shit, everybody buy the Switch. But yeah, I've seen some people freak out, but. I'm not offended. For me, it's fine. I'm one of the dorks that spent $399 on a place or $400 on a PSVR, and it's caked in dust right now because I haven't turned it on in a while.
Sell it to fund your Switch purchase.
Yeah, well, I'm tempted to now because I saw that they're going for like $800 on eBay.
They're really hard to come by.
They're impossible to come by. My local Best Buy hasn't gotten anything. Anyways, back to the Switch. So what it comes with is the dock, which retails separately. Let's get into this now. Their pricing for this stuff is unbelievable. Yeah, they got the console for $299, but the separate Joy-Cons are $49 each or two for $80 if you get the two pack. The Pro Controller is $70. The dock alone, a separate dock, is $90 in case you want to take the Switch around your house or somewhere else. So you got some pretty expensive pricing on accessories for a console that's about average price-wise, I guess you could say. But it comes with the dock. It comes with the tablet thing, the Tegra-based tablet, and the two Joy-Cons. The Joy-Cons, one thing I'm interested in, and I'm working on this article right now, you have a left-hand Joy-Con and a right-hand Joy-Con, and they have very different functionality, right? The left-hand Joy-Con, they both have motion, and it's enhanced motion with what they're calling HD rumble and all that fun stuff. That certainly seems cool. I mean, the motion controls for the Nintendo product, the third generation in a row that they've had it, so they're going to keep it going. The left-hand Joy-Con just has a analog stick and the buttons, and that's kind of it. The right-hand stick.
The left-hand one is also the one that if you're playing two-player, one you give the person you hate because it has centered joystick.
Yes, exactly. A centered joystick when you turn it sideways, exactly. It
looks insane.
The right stick, the right Joy-Con, has all the technology in it. So it has basically everything the left has, but also the NFC readers built into the right Joy-Con and an infrared scanner camera thing, right? So you can, one of the questions is, could you point to the TV screen and use that? But they showed some demos where people were scanning in they were holding it to their face and pretending like they're eating a pizza. And I guess you can point it the way Skylanders Imaginators works, which is coming to launch, is that you don't actually scan your Skylanders in or your or other toys. You actually just point the controller to the Skylander and it scans it in, which is kind of an interesting That's novel right. idea. So it got me instantly thinking too. You could scan 3D if you can scan 3D space, that could be kind of an interesting hack for scanning, you know, a portable scanner. But there's a lot of technology in that one. So I see my issue with that is how you're going to run out of these right sticks pretty quickly, and you're going to be left at home with about 40 of these left-hand side Joy-Cons, which are the shitty Joy-Cons that you give to people you don't like. And you're going to have the right-hand side Joy-Cons with all the power. And you'll have like one of them because they're all going to sell out. And, you know, how do you know if you've got the correct one? Because they're similar looking. So I could see some people buying the right one or the left one too many times and trying to plug it in on the other side and it doesn't fit and having all kinds of issues. So they're almost...
I feel like the single Joy-Cons are the thing that no one's going to buy.
Yeah, no, you're going to have to buy two at a time. Exactly.
I'm surprised they're even doing it.
Yeah, I bought a whole second set, so... I wonder if the single ones are really if you lose one, I don't know. I'm not sure. Or if you have to have
fucking ravine.
Who knows? But the console is touchscreen capacitive 720p, so it's it's comparable to modern phablets, I guess. From what people are saying, the screen quality was actually really nice. It's based on the NVIDIA Tegra, so it's definitely not Xbox One PS4 level. It's a little bit better than the Wii U, I'm guessing. Just the videos that they've shown isn't like super amazing, but you know, I'll have to see it up close.
It seems to have a little bit better aliasing, a little more dynamic range.
Yep.
Seems similar.
And then it's going to launch with Zelda on launch day and 1-2 Switch, and like only four games, only five games on launch day. So those are kind of the basic stats for the Nintendo Switch, and I'm curious to see what each of you gentlemen thought about or think about the Switch and about where it's, you know, what its launch is. So let's start with Sam. Sam, what did you feel about that Switch reveal and the console as a whole and everything around it?
Well, I mean, the whole concept of the Switch being a portable and like on the television to me is like, I don't know, something I've been looking for in consoles for a long time. I was really hoping that the remote play with PlayStation 4 was going to work out a lot better. I've never been able to get that to work when I've been away from my home, and Wi-Fi has been super spotty with that stuff too. But I don't know. Just I am disappointed that it seems like for at least the first 6 months, all it's going to be is a Zelda machine, which I have no problem with. But it seems like Nintendo might have a problem with if they're looking to sell units. I don't know. I mean, I pre-ordered one. I'm assuming all of the rest of you have as well.
Oh, yeah.
I didn't.
No.
Oh, no.
That's $500 and a $400 price.
Yeah, that's true.
Did you just suck it all up at once and be like, I'm going to pre-order an expensive Zelda edition with this, too? Let's just get it all up on Front Street.
I got the special edition. I think
it's a master. Yeah, me too. I got the one that comes with that cool case.
Yeah. Sorry, go ahead. Continue, Sam.
Oh, well, like, and other than that, like, you know, even with the way you want 1-2 Switch, I guess, there's not many reasons that they have shown to have, like, those Joy-Cons as, like, the specific, like, controllers. I will say that what's it called, Snippets or whatever, it looks super exciting, which would be a great, like, two-player proof of, you know, here, take this Joy-Con and I'll take this one and we'll play... like a two-player game. So that seems nice. I think that so far they haven't really shown much that makes me feel great about being a Switch owner for the first year. And I would say that hopefully some of that is being held for E3. But if you look at the announcement as this is the exciting things that are going to make you want to purchase a Switch in the first year, other than Zelda and Mario at the end of the year, there's really not much.
It kind of does seem like they're banking on Zelda being the, you know, kind of the hardcore gamer. I hate to say hardcore, but like the core Nintendo gamer is going to pick up the Switch for Zelda, and use that for their Switch. And then you're going to have a few folks that are also going to pick up 1-2 Switch, I think, because they need to get that casual game in there. So if Nintendo, I mean, everybody who's getting Zelda is going to get it that first month, whether it's for the Switch or for the Wii U, right? And then after that, you have what? You have Mario Kart in April, which is a remake of Mario Kart 8. And you have a couple other games that are either reboots or updates on previous games.
You got ARMS coming in the spring.
You know what? Sadly, that actually looks kind of cool. Yeah, in ARMS a weird way. Really cool. It looks kind of cool. I was actually excited about that. That's the ARMS game is what made me purchase the second set of Joy-Cons. Because I know my daughter's going to have a freaking blast playing that with me. But other than that, you don't have anything coming until Mario Splatoon 2, which for all intents and purposes looks like Splatoon 1.5, and then Mario Odyssey in the fall. But
I never played Splatoon.
Oh, no. Oh, dude, Splatoon is fantastic. Anyways, yeah. It felt to me. I'm kind of in that boat with you too, Sam. I like the idea of I've wanted the Wii U to be something that I could take that controller with me and take it somewhere and play it. The range was horrible on that. Of course, you couldn't get online anywhere, and it sucked because what kind of sucks right now is that the Switch seems like what the Wii U should have been, but in 2012, right?
Yeah.
I almost want like. I would almost want now for Nintendo to have these separate Joy-Cons allow you to connect to any smartphone and use that as your Switch console with like streaming video. I think that to me would have been it's 2017 right now. That would have been ideal to me, right? Because then you could take your game anywhere, whatever device you have, and you're paying for their $80 Joy-Cons and you get the Nintendo content. But I like the idea of the Switch. I often have to. Leave my TV alone and stop playing something because I have my family floating around and they want to watch TV or I'm playing something violent and I can't, I don't want my daughter in the room, that kind of stuff. So, and I'm not worried about the technical aspects of it. I think it's okay that it's not as powerful as the PS4 or the Xbox One. The issue for me is the lack of games, really. It's just, right now they've only announced two big games, Zelda and Mario Odyssey. I think those are probably the two heavy hitters, at least in the U.S. I know in Japan, Splatoon 2 is going to be massive, but
you're not psyched for that really gross version of Bomberman.
You know what? I've heard there are a lot of people hyped up about Bomberman, maybe more so than I thought. I wasn't expecting Bomberman to be as popular as it was, but
you can pick 50 space bucks to continue.
That's crazy. Is that like are they having microtransactions in the damn game? Damn.
Yeah.
But yeah, the idea that there's no package game. I think there are a lot of positives with the Switch. It feels like it's late already in a weird way.
Yeah. I as we've been saying, the console itself, it seems like a great idea. I love that I can, if I'm playing a game and somebody happens to see me playing it, if there is a second player option, I can just rip part of my controller apart and hand it to them so they can try it. And I'm excited for the potential that, indie game developers can look at maybe creating two-player modes where they might not have had one before. Mm-hmm. I know for the Wii U version of Shovel Knight, they added the two-player of that. And that would work just fine on the Switch. Like something like Binding of Isaac will be able to have co-op using the Switch as controller setups. Maybe even like Stardew Valley and games like that.
Yeah.
Which are planning to come to the Switch might be able to take advantage of offering maybe a little tiny co-op mode they wouldn't have otherwise put into it just because you have access to a second controller that easily.
That's true. Yeah. I mean, literally every console is a multiplayer console, right? Every Switch is a built-in multiplayer device. It does have something going for it. I think there's, one of the cool things for me that I do look at that Switch is and this is me as a designer. There are a ton of freaking possibilities with that thing. And I'll stop talking here in a second because I want to hear what Tom and Juan have to say. But I looked at that thing and I thought I was just brainstorming ideas. And I said if you look at what modern tablets and phablets kind of do, accessory makers could have a field day. With the Switch, I mean, you could get a keyboard and mouse that the tablet attaches to, and make the Switch more than just a gaming device. It could be a mini PC in a weird way, right? An Android tablet or whatever that you can get some minor PC functions built in there. It doesn't have a camera in built in, which is you know, kind of a interesting thing. But then an accessory, of course, could be a camera. You can have all kinds of accessories with this thing.
I would have figured at launch somebody would have, like Nyko or something, would have released a right Joy-Con that has the control or has the thumbstick like up at the top, like the other side does. I just feel like there's so many ways that people could develop like third party controllers that make mm-hmm. that thing easier to fit in your hands or make it easier for a control method that you prefer. While still integrating everything that Nintendo is trying to push with the system.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree. So I think there's some cool possibilities from a product standpoint. Nothing's been announced, but we'll wait and see what happens there. You know, accessory manufacturers love to make those controllers and all the extra stuff. So I'm sure a lot of that could be coming. But
like, put out a Zelda game, and you could like shoot things with a crossbow, but you had to put the Switch controllers in the crossbow.
I mean, you could kind of do that. They're small enough. They're small enough. I'm curious you had some good comments on Twitter, so I'm curious to see what you think overall of the Switch and from, you know,
that's. Yeah, I was having a hard time not sounding too salty about it because I have a lot of concerns about this whole the setup that they're doing. Mm-hmm. Like the whole launch lineup, everybody knows that it's very scary.
Very bad, yeah.
Five games.
But five games, yeah, but not all, like one good game, I would say.
Mm-hmm.
The biggest problem, I think, is like I read that only 3% of developers, third party, are developing for the Switch right now. So that's going to take a couple of months for them to catch up. Yep. By the time they are caught up, you already have the Scorpio out. So then you have this huge power leap right from the bat. Sony's not going to be long after that when they're going to announce their next thing, I think, I'm not 100% sure on that one. I think the confidence in this machine from developers is going to wane fast because there's no reason right now, technically, except for you guys, because it's kind of your job to be on board with these things, to buy a Switch day one.
Right. So I agree.
You're gonna wait 6 months, maybe till November, and then it becomes a little bit more valuable. So that is 6-7 months of low install base. So that's going to suck for developers right away. So they're going to see that, okay, no install base. Like, why should I start developing for this already outpowered system?
I don't know if it was a rumor, but somebody posted on Twitter that developers are taking a wait and see approach right now, and they're doing these quick ports because they lost a lot of confidence in the Wii U. That's why you're going to see a FIFA port, Rayman Legends, Just Dance, and Steep ports, yeah. And they're literally pumping things out there almost as if to say, okay, fine, Nintendo, we'll give you something, but you know, we don't have much confidence yet. We're going to wait to see what kind of install base you get.
Yeah, and I think the longer that goes on, the more trouble you're going to see with them. But, you know, you never know. The PS3 had the same kind of issues, but they were coming off the PlayStation 2, not of the Wii U, and I think that's a big difference. So I don't really have an interest in the Switch right now. I might when it becomes a little cheaper. Like, I am buying Zelda on the Wii U because it starts with the Switch, but it also ends the Wii U with that game, and after that you can just pack that system up and
mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I'll buy that on the Wii U, but I think they're gonna have to be very, very careful and really push for those developers to stay with them, because as soon as Scorpio is gonna come out and it's gonna mute the new standard. Like, why would they downport all their games in 2018? I think they're not going to be super excited about that. So I'm afraid that they're going to have a problem again with titles. And I think then trust is going to wave very fast mm-hmm. in the Nintendo console brands. But we'll see. Like, they have surprised before. It's just like I see those games, like the one to Switch and even ARMS, which looks like fun. And it reminds me like the first night I played the Wii with the family, like the original Wii. And it was the best thing ever because you're playing cow race and like mm-hmm. tennis and everybody's having a ton of fun. And then
you put never it away. Play it again.
Yeah, exactly. Like, they sold like 100 million of those, but I think like 100 million times they played it one night. And you don't want to be that guy every time, right? Like, oh, you want to break out the Wii and play some ARMS when you have friends over? Because after two times, you're going to be like, no, man, let's just hang out and have a glass of wine. So I'll see. But I think tech-wise, it's very interesting. And I travel a lot, so I thought maybe it's going to be super interesting for me to bring along. but I think they put a little bit too much in it. Like, if they would have just had normal controls and not with all the gadgets in it, I would have been more interested, I think. Because this is expensive tech to lose on a plane.
Yeah. I kind of wonder if the console lends itself really well to upgrades, right? So you have, you don't have to buy a new dock. You don't have to buy new Joy-Cons. You literally just buy that tablet part, which could be, you know, that could be $200, let's say, or $150. So I could see maybe the Switch. I'm speculating a Switch Pro or a Switch 2 or something could be an updated Tegra or another chipset, you know, processor in a couple of years, 2-3 years, and all your accessories carry over without issue. But that's
you could just switch the tablet in and out.
There you go.
There you go. But you know, it's gonna be, from like a business thing, very interesting to follow, at least for a couple of years.
You know what could be? Now that you've got a comic talking about it, and Tom, we'll get to you in just a quick second here. I see you're yawning already, Tom. the Switch could be the kids' tablet, because you know, you hand your kids an iPad, you hand your kids an Android tablet or an iPhone, and those are really expensive, $600, $700, $800 pieces of tech. A lot of people want to buy their kids a tablet. If they can position the tablet or the Switch in some way as a kid's tablet, man, you could almost have a kid's version of the Switch with super bright poppy. Oh, there's the neon right there, the neon version. But you can have it with, you know, access to Nintendo's eShop, very simple, some preloaded software that are kid-based, and you've got a $299 tablet for your kids with just YouTube, Netflix, all the stuff that my daughter uses on her on our tablet. I mean, you could put on the Switch, and if it, you know, the rumor is it's an Android-based operating system or has some Android kernel in it, it could be, you know, that could be a an opportunity there for app devs. Maybe the Switch is leaning more towards app developers instead of kind of console gaming developers. So
yeah, but that's like a smart idea, not a Nintendo idea.
That's true. Nintendo, you gotta hire us. I'm a designer. I can help you out. Tom, what are your thoughts about the Switch?
The first thing that jumped out to me was the 2.5 to 6 hour battery life. Mm-hmm. Like the fact that they're like, hey, our battery life is so bad that we're going to sell battery packs.
I totally agree with you. That 2.5 hour battery life, what was it, 3 hours for Zelda? Granted, you're looking at so this is when it's in tablet mode, right? So when you're sitting on a plane or whatever. Granted, any game I play on my, when I was playing Pokemon Go this summer, I drained through that battery in like an hour's time. I think an hour and a half on my 6 Plus over the summer on Pokemon Go. But that's not necessarily an exact comparison there.
But you put your Vita in standby in 2012, and you can still turn it on right now.
I've tried. I actually can't turn it on because I put it on in standby in 2012, and it hasn't powered on in the 4 years since then.
I was legit bummed out to see they got rid of Street Pass for that thing.
Yeah, that's kind of weird. Although the was it Reggie or somebody said that they're working on a successor to the 3DS, and it'll be separate from the Switch. And I'm okay with them getting rid of Miiverse. Miiverse was, it died really early. I hardly ever use it. I just go on there to get the points for my Nintendo. But
they're gonna replace it with Miitomo too.
There you go, Miitomo too. You know, I wouldn't be surprised if Miitomo or something like that is built into there, a very simplified social network. And that's the big thing for me, is they haven't announced their social network online structure. They said, yeah, you'll find out more. Yeah, it's paid. I'm okay with the paid online. I think all the console manufacturers right now doing it. You're not okay with it?
No, because they've proven time and time again that they don't know how to make an online service that's willing to, that's good.
Well, they're not handling it. They're not handling it. Dana or DNA, whatever, is handling all their online stuff now. So DNA seems to have somewhat of an understanding of networking. But yeah, I wouldn't put it, no, I agree with you. I would never allow Nintendo to to manage online. They don't know what they're doing.
They have to give that thing away for three months or so, because if they just launched it, no one would get it.
That's a good point. Good point.
Another thing was, do you guys remember their voice chat app that they're doing? We basically built Skype for your phone.
So and I made that online joke, that tweet as well. I thought, you know, they the way Reggie said it was, hey, you're going to be able to communicate with anybody you want anywhere with the Switch. You know, you're obviously going to be only on Wi-Fi on a plane or wherever, but you communicate with anybody through your phone. That's where you're going to be using your social networking for this. I'm thinking, wait a minute, I don't want to use my phone when I'm playing a console. Although I looked on Amazon and there was a ton of Switch headsets that have already launched, and they have chat built into them, and it's just specifically designed to fit into the Switch. So I'm curious to see what they're actually, but not having that explained is a big issue, because now I don't want to have to use my phone as my communication device.
Yeah, they had this technology already on the NES, like you had to use your rotary phone and
talk
to your friend like this, like I'm playing Mario 3. Like, now, what kind of technology is that?
If it's in addition to being able to talk through the Switch, like if you could say, okay, you're talking on the Switch right now, whatever, I'm going to go into an area where there's Wi-Fi, but the connection's not that great, but we can still play online. So I'll use my phone and plug into my phone and talk through my Switch that way. And that could actually be kind of an interesting, you know, or if you're not even on your Switch, if you're just walking around the house or you're at work, you're not playing your game, you hop into the Nintendo's Switch app and you can still chat with your friends who are in the lobbies and chatting and stuff. I mean, that could be kind of an interesting way to stay, stay connected. But if that's your only way to communicate, then yeah, I can yell across the room better than.
Yeah. And it also, like, it seems like, who are they targeting with this? Like kids with their smartphones that they have to download an app with their friends, or is it like the older gamer that has that already? It's very odd. Mm-hmm. Maybe you don't want your kids on like voice chat anyway, but it's a little all over the place.
It's very weird right now. It's so nebulous, and they glazed over it so quickly on their presentation. Tom, what else did you what else are you thinking about the Switch? You pre-ordered one, I know you said. Did you get the neon or the gray? Tom disappeared when we asked him that question.
No.
While he joined us, Sam, which did you pre-order, the neon or the gray?
I have the gray, but to talk about like their like online stuff, mm-hmm. I feel like we don't know really the technical specs 100%, right. Do we?
No,
but we also don't know anything about the system outside of what games running on it look like.
Yes.
We saw, if the UI was seen for like 0.5 seconds during that presentation. And other than like knowing that there's going to be paid online, and oddly you'll get a game, but only for a month, and it might be on NES and it might be on Super Nintendo, which might have weird online features that weren't there before.
Mm-hmm.
Like it seems like what would be like a nice 20-minute block in a Sony or Microsoft presentation just was completely absent from the Microsoft or from Nintendo. And so we don't know, is everything going to be app-based? And if it's Android, like, does that smartphone app that allows you to chat also an app that can run on the device?
Mm-hmm.
And, like, do we see, you know, like, because when you don't talk about, like, how the system is going to run things.
The operating system, yeah, the UI. Yeah,
you can, because, like, think back about how they didn't mention about anything about the Wii's operating system other than, oh, we can make Wii's, and then the channel system happened.
Right.
And that was not anything worthwhile, really. And, I mean, an app ecosystem would work. It's just, we need to, like, well, I guess we don't need to know, but if you're trying to convince people that, hey, we're going to do fine this time with online and the way that our, like, system like UI runs things.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't do any of that. They just basically went with, hey, you guys like Zelda? I feel like a lot of that presentation was just, hey, you guys like Zelda, right? Like, you guys still like Zelda? Also, I can feel ice cubes in a glass. Like that's all I really got from that presentation.
The I really think that this first chunk of the Switch's life prior to E3 is, let's just get this thing out to the hardcore Nintendo fans. They're gonna buy it no matter what, so let's get it out there. We don't have to tell anybody any other information. The core fans who own PS4s and Xbox Ones and whatever, they don't care. They don't necessarily care about the Switch. So let's just get get the Nintendo folks settled and figured out and sold, and then we'll introduce the online stuff. Then we'll get that stuff going, and hopefully we can wrangle in the other, you know, the other buyers. It kind of seems like that. Yeah, you kids like Zelda, and you like Mario Kart, right? Please. Sorry, Tom. We're still talking about the online infrastructure and how we don't have any idea. We have no idea how it's gonna take
place. I have zero faith.
Yeah, exactly. You're very loud, by the way, in here.
Oh, sorry.
Popping. yes, you have zero faith. But yeah, if Sam brought up a good point, if this is supposedly the Android base or some Android kernel, and if it can have apps built in or designed for it, you know, could it be the same app that's on the Switch is on your phone? So even when you're not connected, you're not playing Switch, you can still chat with people and go from there. I don't know. It's very unknown. It's very not scary, but it makes it difficult to understand what Nintendo is really going for. But I was curious, Sam bought the gray one. I bought the neon. I pre-ordered the neon one. Which one did you pre-order? I'm just curious.
I got the neon.
Okay, I'll tell you why I picked up the neon one. It's because what I said earlier about the Joy-Cons getting them mixed up. I will always know now that the red one is on one side and the blue one is on the other side. That's gonna be very easy for me to figure out. In fact, I'm gonna buy another neon set just so I can make sure that the red ones are all on one side and the blue ones are all on the other side. It's a very confusing little design.
That would bother me.
I got it because I'm an asshole who wears like Hawaiian shirts.
Sorry, what were you saying? Ass all the time. Yeah. Sam, what were you saying?
I was just saying, like, that would bother me the whole time I'm playing that thing. Like, anytime I had to use the tablet and look down at it and see that one hand is blue and one hand is red, I would just be so mad at myself.
Well, they have the appliques out, right? There's the Zelda. You can buy it online. They have the face covers and appliques for the Wii controller. For the Switch Con, the Joy-Cons, to give it that Zelda flair. But, I want a white one because I think that would actually look really nice to have a white console or white portable. Like I've wanted that white 3DS XL, but it never really came over to the States. And there was a white Vita for like a half hour when the Vita was still around. Hopefully we can get some nice colors.
My dream that will never happen is for them to be like, hey, we put out this disc. It has a bunch of NES games on it. And now SNES games. Well, and it comes with a Joy-Con that looks like a SNES controller.
You know what? I mean, those are they feel like easy wins for Nintendo, right? Here's a disc. You all love the NES Classic Edition. It was the number one most popular thing that you couldn't buy. And it was money left on the table. Let's sell you the NES Joy-Con Edition. So it comes with a cart. And you get a Joy-Con looking like the NES or a Super NES version or whatever. And that's how you get the
weird thing that no one talked about was that thing was back in stock when Switches launched.
I was looking for it. I couldn't find it.
Because like when I launched BestBuy.com, the last thing I tried to buy was the NES Classic. And like for a split second, it was there because I had to remove it from my cart.
Nice, 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 nice.
I don't want that crap anymore.
That disappear again, but yeah, I mean, there's opportunities. Who knows if Nintendo is able to capitalize it? I will say I did like their stage show from the standpoint of they actually tried instead of doing just a regular direct and just some folks talking. That Sony one for the Pro and the PS4 Slim back in September was god awful.
Well, that was just that wasn't for us. That was a business presentation.
It was a business presentation, but it was so bad. It was such a bad business presentation.
You'd rather have an old man in a lab coat trying to contort his body into the shape of a cube.
I think Mark Cerny is a nice dude, but that guy will put you to sleep with his dulcet.
Oh no, Mark Cerny like looks like the type of person who would have like bodies buried in his floorboards, but like he knows what he's talking about.
Apparently we have a YouTube live chat going and our good old friend Aaron is yelling at us on this live chat. Sorry, Aaron, we're not listening to you. We don't. He says, hello, yes, first time caller, long time listener. Those tiny controllers look very tiny, and I am a giant. Very big hands, huge hands. This seems like it's going to be an issue.
Huge.
Huge. Yeah, I'm curious. None of us have tried it. I know it's going to be at PAX South in a couple weeks here. I don't think any of us are headed to PAX South, but...
I think too, but it'll already be out by then. We'll have it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. We'll have to coordinate if we're gonna be bringing ours to PAX. I won't be bringing mine to PAX
East. I'll be bringing mine.
Absolutely no. Are you? There's no reason for me to bring mine to PAX East, but
I want to be that asshole on the plane.
Yeah, there you go. So, it kind of in summary with the Switch, it sounds like a couple of us are like, hey, you know, hey, it's a Nintendo console, let's get it. There's some interesting possibilities, but for them, that's literally, it's like we're like, I don't know. I don't think anybody knows right now what's gonna happen. So it's so nebulous. I went into it pessimistic. Not pessimistic, actually. I went into it not expecting much, and I didn't get much out of it, but I got Zelda, and that may be enough to get together. I do like the technology in those Switch controllers. All those leaked patents that went through, the patent applications over the last, like, 3 years, every single one happened. So they had the infrared controller. They had the two separate sliding controllers. Everything Nintendo put out over the last, like, 2.5-3 years came true, which was kind of bizarre, so... Whatever. Final thoughts on the Switch? Anybody want to mention anything, or are we ready to jump into our favorite games of the year?
I can't believe I paid $100 for a Zelda game.
Oh yeah.
I'm gonna get it for $40 on the Wii U.
There you go. Yeah.
Yeah, you're gonna have a cool case for it, and like the coin that they gave out at E3, and like
It's funny because I saw a lot of people saying, I can't believe I paid $100 or $130 for Zelda games. Like, yeah, you fuckers are the ones that pay the $170 for the stupid Call of Duty or Mass Effect with a goddamn Normandy model. It's like, no, shut up. Everybody buys these stupid collector's editions. You don't need a collector's edition because I'm staring at my pile of stuff that I'm throwing up on eBay, all these collector's editions that I bought that I don't want. I'm an idiot for buying, but sorry.
Hit me with a list of that stuff after this, because I need stuff for a new set.
Really, the only thing I bought, it's funny, the only thing I bought that Zelda thing for was the case, so I can take my stupid console.
The case is real cool.
Yeah. And the soundtrack.
Too.
Okay, games of the year. So we're going to chat a little bit about what our favorite games of the year are, because... by the way, Aaron again says, I cannot overstate how big my hands are. They have their own postal codes. Yes, we know. You are not related to Donald Trump. We understand that. I'm going to say that Wout also is a big dude. He may give you – all you Canadians, people who live in Canada, are giants. Yeah, there you go. we'll let you two battle it out. I think Aaron's on one side of Canada, and Wout, you're somewhere on the other side. sorry to live dox you guys on – on SideQuest. Let's get into our games of the year. And there were, I was surprised at the amount of content that came out in 2016, because going into it, things seemed to be delayed or canceled. We had a lot of good shit that came out this year. And what we typically do is SideQuest, and we stopped doing our single game of the year with our voting and stuff, because
one was the best video game, so like you couldn't keep doing it because you already named the best video game.
Literally, yep. We'll hold that for like our PAXs and our E3s and our games of the show. But I think it's nice to get a personal, because all of us are different. We have different tastes. We have different games. We have time to play. We're on other projects, and so I think doing the personal best ofs is the way to go. At least that's the way we feel over at SideQuesting, and it makes it a little more of a personal touch. So. We had some great lists. We had some great single posts, and I know Wout had a really good. Your story is very similar to mine with Pokemon Go, and that's why I have it on my list. But tell me give me a run on you. I know Pokemon Go is right up there for you, but tell me a little bit about why you felt that was one of your favorite games of the year.
It wasn't necessarily like my favorite game that I enjoyed the most, but I think it meant the most for gaming in general. I think that it was a phenomenon that we won't see anytime soon. So I just felt like that needs to be said, because it's not going to show up in a lot of goatee lists or whatever. But the joy I've had with that game, phenomenal. Like when I went to visit my parents and my family back in the Netherlands, we went to the beach twice with my nephews, who were like 4 and 8 and everything in between, and they were just running around on the beach catching Pokemon, no idea what they were doing. And my parents were like super into it. They knew where all the Pokestops were in the neighborhood, and they went for Pokeballs. Like, that is insanity. Wow. Like, no other game will ever do that to my family. So that is just something special. We're never going to see that again. And every time I talk about Pokemon Go, like developers are like, well, they've had so many missed opportunities and it could have been so much better. Yes, yes, and yes, it could have been a completely different game, but it would not have had the same effect. It would have just been a Pokemon game that a lot of people would have loved, but it would not have mattered to the other 80 billion people that they reach with this game. So that was the one thing. But for the rest, I think this year for me has been the year of Square Enix. Like, they have given me so much playtime this year with Lara Croft on Lara Croft Go, I think. Was it this year? Was it last year?
Yeah. I remember.
Rise of the Tomb Raider, which came out on PS4 because I didn't have an Xbox One. Hitman was phenomenal. And then they killed it at the end of the year with Final Fantasy 15.
Yes. So I'm
great year for Square
Enix. They had a fantastic year. They really did have a fantastic year. Lara Croft Go. It may have come out last year.
I think it was 2015. Yeah.
Yeah. But it survived throughout this year, and I think Deus Ex Go was their next one after that.
Oh, right? Deus Ex Go and Deus Ex this year. Although I didn't finish that game, it was a little overwhelming. If you never played the other games, but overall, phenomenal year. Square Enix. Oh my god.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I know a couple of the other guys have been playing. I know Tom, you've been playing. Were you playing Final Fantasy?
Yeah, I finished Final Fantasy.
You finished Final Fantasy. Yeah, that's one I haven't gotten into. But Tom, tell me some of your favorite games of the year.
Hitman is real great.
Hitman is real great.
Hitman is straight up like one of my favorite games ever.
It's that game. That was another game that people did not have a lot of faith in when it was announced, because that whole episodic structure, it was like, what are they doing? This is so bizarre. But man, it worked out perfectly for them. It was the right way to do Hitman.
An old man last night and took his hair and then killed a robot AI and then murdered a guy in surgery with a surgery robot and then on a snowmobile. It was pretty great.
What weren't the wet bandits one of the hits?
Yeah, you killed the wet bandits.
That's insane.
You get some of the challenges are like you have to knock them out three times with bricks. You have to like do all this stuff. They're all like Home Alone related challenges. Yeah, and they've been supporting that game like crazy. Like, they're still putting out the elusive targets.
Yeah,
and they're still really hard. It's crazy.
It's divided up into seasons, right? And are they in their second season or they're starting it up?
They're working on the second season now.
Okay.
Yeah.
So there were.
It's on my to-do list. Yeah.
It's so good, and they're putting out the physical version soon.
I have not heard a bad thing about Hitman, at all. Like, not a single peep from people saying that they didn't like the direction that was going in. So kudos to them. What else?
Yeah.
Oh, sorry, go ahead.
No, I said if there's something you don't like about Hitman, it's just because you don't like the game and it's just not for you, because everything that's in the game is phenomenal. It's so good.
Mm-hmm. It's so good.
Yeah.
Doom's pretty great.
That's pretty on my pile of shame. I'm staring at it right now.
That campaign is pretty good. So play through that and then just throw it in the trash, because you never need to play anything else on that disc.
That may be what happens. I'm finishing up Uncharted 4 right now, so that'll be the next one.
Continue. Oh, what do you think of that so far?
I'll tell you when I get to my list.
Super Hot is fantastic.
Yeah, Super Hot. That's one I want to play. Is the VR version already out?
Or is that VR version is out, but it's only for Oculus.
Okay. All right.
And it's like kind of a different game, but it's still like great in all the same ways. Mm-hmm. It's on, I think right now it's just for, you can get that on PC and Xbox One. Super Hot. So I definitely recommend getting it for either that. The Xbox One version plays real well. I played it with a controller.
Cool.
Yeah.
What else? You had a good list of games.
I did. I played like 150 games last year. So
finished four.
Stardew Valley. I've talked about that ad nauseum. Yeah. That's a great game. It keeps getting better. I started playing
all of
it again.
Everybody on the site has played and in love with Stardew Valley, except for me. I'm the one person that has not. I haven't even purchased it, unfortunately. I'm just seeing it now. I haven't even purchased it. Maybe
it'll be your wife. It's phenomenal.
Okay.
It's phenomenal like four times already, but yeah.
Oh, nice.
And Final Fantasy 15 is great that the last like quarter of it exists.
That's another game that people were, I saw mixed previews and folks were having some issues early on, but it's another game that has kind of pervaded, or I don't know what the terminology is, but it's another game that has done really well and has a lot of good glowing reviews and comments.
The That game is 14 chapters, and the first 12 are phenomenal.
And I know. So if you guys, if you want to see some fantastic, fantastic storytelling for Final Fantasy 15 experiences, well, you're gonna have to take, you're gonna have to storify all your tweets about Final Fantasy 15 because they were so great. To like, I'll just on a random Thursday night or Friday night, I'll just see a tweet pop up about what latest point you're at. Of it was pretty good. You got me more interested.
I'll fight Tom on a couple of things on the last couple of chapters, because I think two of the chapters are deliberately annoying, and that is to actually make a point. But I don't want to talk about it now because we'll do it offline, because Dali hasn't played it yet.
Yeah,
but I think they do some stuff on purpose.
They straight up what? Yeah, they did stuff on purpose, and then they straight up had to go, "We're patching it down the line to fix it."
Yeah, that is true. That chapter, yes, but the one before that, we will talk.
Yeah.
it is very interesting, I think, from a game design perspective.
So yeah, I mean, you had a good list, very good list there. You also had I'm just popping through your list right now. Obviously, Overwatch was a big one. You liked the Watch games, but you had Firewatch as well. So
yeah, I went Overwatch and Firewatch back to back.
But you listed
was Firewatch last year.
Yeah, Firewatch was February.
Wow. It's February, yeah. Just snuck in at the beginning of the year. Another game that I have downloaded. It's only like, what, 2 hours, 3 hours, something like that?
It's like you can do it in one sitting, and I actually think it benefits from doing it in one sitting.
Okay, cool. But the one I wanted to pick your brain about was Watch Dogs 2.
Watch Dogs 2 is such a cool game.
Which is so like polar opposite to the first Watch Dogs, which had a lot of issues and a lot of
main character in that game was terrible. Everything in that game was bad.
So you like Watch Dogs 2? I've heard good things about Watch Dogs 2.
There's a whole sequence where you have to steal a Knight Rider car by a fake John Travolta in a fake Scientology church, and then you have to do like this crazy race through the streets while fireworks are going off and Turbo Lover is playing.
Nice.
It's super cool. Like, it's just a bunch of really fun and smart decisions in that game. It doesn't take itself anywhere near as seriously as the first Watch Dogs
did.
It just feels fun. Like, the characters are having fun, you're having fun. There's a really great conversation between two characters while they're driving about like who would win in a fight, Batman or the Predator.
That's a series that I will not be able to get into, just like Assassin's Creed. I've tried, but other things come up at the same time, and I don't think I've. It may be years down the line when they do their eventual, 4K versions of these games that I'll get into it. So I don't know. I want to try it, but I don't see myself having any time to do another ginormous open world game with what's coming in 2017. So, great list, good stuff. I know Overwatch was everywhere this year, and I finally got into it over the holiday and enjoyed it. But I'm gonna get in my list real quick, and then we'll let Sam speak as well. I had Pokemon Go on there as well, because for me it dominated the summer. I've never had my daughter. My daughter's technology addict like I am, right? So it's like it's iPad, it's console, it's TV, and she'll play with her toys while she's watching TV, and she does, she's kind of multitasks. In July, when Pokemon Go launched, she wanted to go outside several times per day just to walk around the neighborhood and catch Pokemon. And she was very active over the summer because of that. She met a lot of kids around the neighborhood.
Exhausting.
It is. It's so fun, though. It's so worth it. But we would go on Pokewalks like once or twice, three times a day, and we would meet all these neighbors who were doing the same thing with their kids. I remember one time we were going on a Pokewalk, and we're walking down our street or one of the side streets. And we see a bunch of kids run by go by on their bikes, and they're yelling, "I got one! There's a Charmander over there! There's a Charmander!" And my daughter goes, I just caught it too. I just caught it too. And the kids would like stop and came over and asked us questions about what else we found. And it was, it's a very simple game, and there's a lot of wasted potential in there, and the mechanics aren't always great and things don't always work. And there's a lot of bugs, but I'll be damned if it wasn't just perfect timing for, perfect experience for the summer. So it was well done for the Pokemon company, Nintendo, and everyone involved. Square Enix wise, Dragon Quest VII, which is what I'm playing right now. I love the Dragon Quest series. I think it battles between that and some of the classic Final Fantasy games as my favorite RPG series or games of all time. So Dragon Quest VII, which came out in like early 2000s, I think, somewhere around there, was a PS1 game or PS2. I couldn't remember. It was PS1, yeah. Came out right at the tail end of the PS1, I think. But just a fantastic role-playing game. I'm so glad it's on the 3DS, and I've put in like 60 hours of it already after I polished off Xenoblade 3D earlier this year, or a few weeks ago. Yeah, I love it. It's great. If you love if you just love classic JRPGs, this is it. And it's so simple. It fills my need for the game that I can just kind of pick up and play RPG-wise, because it's very easy to get into. I love the series. On that point, Severed was awesome. I know that game came out earlier this year for like Vita, and then it transferred over.
So good.
Yeah, then it came out for iOS and Wii U and 3DS, and I played it on all those consoles, all the devices, and it holds up. It's just beautiful visuals. It's such a good. It's again, it's kind of a simple ish game. It's like Fruit Ninja. You're slashing, but there's combos, and there's some cool complications that are thrown into the situations there. And it's an RPG. It's a very light RPG. There's some cool stuff, and the plot is really cute. The plot is very nice. I hate seeing cute. Sorry, I saw my daughter walk by. And a great game. I would highly recommend picking up Severed if you're into a good pick up and go RPG light game. And it's great visuals. You know, it's the same guys that created
Guacamelee.
Yeah, there you go. Guacamelee.
Drinkbox.
Yep, Drinkbox and Mutant Muds or Mutant Blobs Attack, whatever. Love that developer. They've always done great work, and this latest one, Severed, is a must-buy, total purchase for me. Arkham VR. I got into VR this year with the PSVR. I mean, obviously I had like Google Cardboard crap, but Arkham VR was fantastic. It's phenomenal. I wish there was a full game out of it. It's an hour, maybe hour 15 minutes, hour and a half if you put some time into doing some of the unlockables. But it's so good. You feel like Batman, and it's so well done. And Rocksteady did just absolute phenomenal job of capturing what it is to be Batman. I felt like Batman. It was the Batman, the detective, and not the action hero. So it's easily, for me, it's the best VR game this year for what the potential of VR could be. I loved it. Fantastic. And the last couple, Uncharted 4, just so good. And I'm playing through it now. I think I'm halfway through. I'm halfway through the game. I'm like, I think level or chapter 14 or 15 or something. And it's so good. I finally picked it back up after a long lull. There are some really cheesy, unbelievable parts. Like, you can't, if you're falling off a ledge and you grab onto a finger hold that's millimeters deep, just enough so you can jump off that finger hold and throw a rope onto a tree branch that's hanging off like about 200 feet into the distance and nail it perfectly and totally be fine with it and not have an issue as Nathan Drake, which he doesn't. It breaks the reality a little bit, but it's still fun. So yeah, Uncharted, it is just gorgeous. Definitely. And it's just, you know, it was interesting plot-wise. I think it's actually the most solid plot in the series thus far. I don't know if you guys have played it, Uncharted 4?
Yeah,
it's the whole plot with his wife. I mean, that hits home. If you're a married person or someone in this with a significant other in a relationship, you think you can kind of relate a little bit to what Drake goes through in there. So it's I liked it. I love Uncharted, the series, and nice way to tie it up.
You know what's weird? About Uncharted 4? Like, when you're playing it, it's such a cool game. Like, it's awesome, and you're having such a good time. Now, like, almost a year later, I remember nothing.
Yeah, that's true.
Like, it's so forgettable.
That is true. Yeah, I've noticed the same thing for playing it. Yeah.
Well, even with Firewatch, I still remember the opening of Firewatch because it was so good and did not expect it.
Oh, because it cuts like a fucking knife.
Oh yeah, it's terrible. But I barely remember anything from Uncharted 4. And it's such a good game while you play it. But it's
Yeah, and that's why, like, Uncharted. I picked up the collection earlier this year, so I have the collection, and I have Uncharted 4, and I'll probably be getting rid of Uncharted 4 and keeping the collection around. So, not that I remember much of the collection. I remember like spots here or there, but It's yeah, while you're playing, it's fantastic. And then last but not least for me is Forza Horizon 3.
Oh, shocker.
Yeah, this is the best racing game of all time. I'm going to say it right. It's the best racing game of all time. It has unseated the Gran Turismos and the you know, the Forza propers. It is so fun. It's designed really well. I hated the idea of Forza Horizon when it was initially previewed and shown at E3 many moons ago. I thought, you know, driving a Lamborghini through a rice field or whatever it was just a wheat field. I'm like, this is the worst thing. I'm a car guy, and it was terrifying me. It was causing like nightmares and tears to see a developer do that to these supercars. And then I'm like, you know what? I gotta try it. So I've tried it, and I've been in love with Forza. I love Forza Horizon more than I love Forza proper because it is so fun. It's so easy to play, and it's a hardcore racing game if you put the right kind of time and emphasis on it. But it's also a fantastically casual racing game. It's like Burnout Paradise, right? Burnout Paradise was that, and this has picked it up quite a bit since then. So yeah, Forza Horizon 3 just. So fun, and I haven't had a chance to play it in like a couple months here, but I'm still I haven't played it since I think middle of November, and I'm still like wanting to play it and looking at it, and I feel sad for not picking it up since then, but God, it's so good. Play it. Forza Horizon 3, best racing game ever. Anyways, that's my list. Yes, I know, Tom, I'm a car guy, so I have to throw something racing in there, but so Sam, what are your favorites of the year?
Well, we already briefly mentioned Overwatch, but I kind of want to bring it back again, just because, man, I mentioned it in my article, which will hopefully be up either tomorrow or Tuesday. Every time I tell Deli that I have free time, that immediately disappears. Movement is the most important part of games to me, and not like Overwatch nails character movement like 20 times over, or however many characters are in that game. There's just so many like ways to interpret your character and then combine them with others and like feed off of each other while also like seeing like somebody who's better than you at a character that you like and like stealing their play style for yourself for the next time. And I say that since I haven't liked shooters really since Halo 2, I've played a whole bunch since then. And I know that like everybody was super excited about Titanfall and Doom, and even I guess Battlefield 1 was good this year. But like I haven't spent like more time with a shooter since probably Halo or Halo 2. Overwatch is just such an incredible game.
I'm right there with you, and I was playing Titanfall 2, and I've been playing Call of Duty Infinite Warfare, and while they're solid shooters, great, you know, the online is good. The thing I liked about Overwatch is that when I play any other FPS or any other shooter, if I play online, I get slaughtered and I feel bad for playing shittier than – for being the shitty guy, because I always feel like, yeah, okay, I'm the one who's going to take the 72 kills against me for my team. So just put me out there. I'm going to die. I don't even know why I'm playing. I'm embarrassing myself. Meanwhile, with Overwatch, I am totally fine dying over and over again because I know that, hey, that's just part of the game. Like you're supposed to – basically die to advance the game forward, and I have a blast playing it. It's totally so cool. Accessible from that standpoint. It's totally cool to die.
Some
it's
people
totally
are
fine.
Just casual babies, Dolly. It's all right.
I'm a casual baby. But no, I love Overwatch for that reason, is that it feels like, I hate to say it feels like Splatoon, but it doesn't. That it's the thing I liked about Splatoon is it doesn't penalize your team if you die, and Overwatch doesn't penalize your team if I die. In fact, it's like, yeah, whatever, go ahead. You're gonna learn. You're gonna keep learning. Watch everybody else plays, and that's how I've been learning Overwatch and enjoying Overwatch. I totally hear what you're saying, Sam, and I completely agree with you. Completely agree with you.
Yeah, and I like of course there is a level of skill that once you've been playing Overwatch for however many hours, there is a level where it crosses over from being like, okay, I can get away with anything, do anything I want, and be fine, to where it does cross over to, okay, I need to be playing a role and I need to be like present in the situations to create advantages for my team. But I feel like by the time it gets there, you've already played for so long and you've already like found your niche in what makes Overwatch special to you, that if you're continuing to play it by that point, like you are skilled enough at a character or a set of characters to enter that sort of competition and be able to compete with those around you.
Yeah.
Also, adding like there's so many different options to play Overwatch other than just the normal choose, you know, 6v6. And they keep adding more with all the events. Like Lucio Ball was really exciting and a great name for that game. And they had the like player versus AI that came out for Halloween. Just they're constantly making that game exciting. And hopefully they'll continue through 2017. And if it's Blizzard, probably through 2025 also.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it's a great game. I love it.
What else, Sam? Game I want to talk to you about right
What's
now.
What's that? Okay.
And I want to hear Sam talk about Tokyo Mirage Sessions.
Do it, Sam.
Okay. I mean, Tokyo Mirage Sessions. First of all, the only reason I played it has to do with the fact that Persona 5 was promised to me this year, and then it didn't happen. but man. I've been like a relapsed JRPG fan as of late. Final Fantasy 15 was great, mm-hmm. But Sharp FE like hits me at such a weird spot in like games and like entertainment that I like watching that like I did, like it's been such a long time since a JRPG to do that for me. I the sense of like friendship and community that gets built in that game. It's just so nice, and like we need so much more of that in our world. And they're all super excited about music and to be friends together and to go out on these adventures and save each other. And like it's all told.
Text teacher.
Wait, what was that?
Did you get text messages from your drunk teacher?
Yeah, right. It's like there's just like so much like weird like I guess like human stuff. That's mixed with just the most ridiculous, like, oh, I have a weird summon that, like, just comes out of me that is, like, music-based, and they also happen to be from Fire Emblem because Brand got me. I don't understand half of it, and, like, I don't know, the main character wears blue, which is really helpful, so I don't know. Like,
it's a very pretty game, and I actually love the battles for it. It's just a visual smorgasbord, I guess.
Yeah, and there's so many like really like nice touches, like even with like battling systems in the gameplay where there's the follow-up attacks and like the game lets you know that by like their portraits being excited or being depressed that they can't help you out. And there's just a lot of like really smart decisions that I feel are like helpful for people that can't read the language that a JRPG is. I feel like if you sat somebody who had never played a JRPG in front of Final Fantasy 15, almost none of that would make sense. And even as somebody who's played a lot of like Final Fantasies, I had to basically sit in the first area for a good couple hours just to figure out like, okay, this is how combat works. And like, I understand that like I can't drive the car everywhere. In fact, like it's almost more convenient to ditch the car half the time. But like Sharp FE just like guides you through like not difficult dungeons. As soon as you figure out like what the sort of gimmick is, like it all the puzzles kind of make sense, and it teaches you combat and how you can take advantage of certain weaknesses and stuff without like trying to hide those weaknesses from you. I don't know, it just makes a bunch of really smart decisions wrapped in a very friendly package.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I haven't finished it. It's a long game. It's actually longer than Final Fantasy 15, but that's a game that would make a fantastic portable game, which is like, hey, maybe they should re-release it for the Switch when people might actually pick it up.
Yeah, I was slightly
for the Vita.
What's that?
For the Vita.
Yeah. Well, that's sorry. Yeah.
I was slightly hoping that we were going to get a Tokyo Mirage Sessions like 1.5 with the Switch announcement.
Mm-hmm.
But it might be a little too soon for that. Plus, I don't know how well it sold. But yeah, I don't know.
Not well at all. Pretty horribly. Yeah. But then that's just indicative of the Wii U in general.
Yeah, but it's sort of like a Sharp FE plus like Pokemon Sun and Moon. And also Stardew Valley to an extent, like all kind of like encompass this like community, we're all friends, like we can do this together vibe that I don't know, I just really wanted to play this year, I guess. Mm-hmm. And like I understand like all of them have their own issues, excluding like Stardew Valley with like there being just really dumb, goofy like things that happen in it that like if you look at it like make no sense whatsoever. But I don't know, that's almost part of the charm for those things.
And maybe that was, you know, we just needed positivity this past year, and games like Tokyo Mirage and Stardew Valley and Doom brought that level of positivity that and the smiles that we all needed.
Yeah. to counter directly off of that though, as far as like my favorite single player experience this year, and I know Tom, I saw your list. Hyper Light Drifter is probably the most depressing thing I've played in a long time. but at the same time, it's like, as far as gameplay and the mechanics of moving and adding that movement into combat, like, man, it was so special. In my article for Game of the Year stuff, I compared like Hyper Light Drifter to playing like an instrument. Where there's a million different ways to play that wrong, and there's like only a couple of ways to like play that correctly, but it's your interpretation of playing that correctly, and like how like you can basically like enter into a combat and sight read it like you would sight read music, and how like you know where you have to rest, where you have to be aggressive, like where you have to like sort of take a step back and like consider where people are moving. A lot of games go for that sort of like top-down Legend of Zelda type exploration of dungeons, but man, Hyper Light Drifter just really did it like perfectly.
Awesome. Very cool. Any other games, or is that the kind of the major ones?
That's the major ones. Okay. I had mentioned Sun and Moon, and that's 100% because that game is goofy and dumb and makes absolutely no sense.
I'm like your slowly character, chipping away at that game. Slowly chipping away.
Your character has absolutely no reaction to anything that's going on. Like, it's almost better if you just consider that your character can't understand a word of what everybody's saying. And like your rival or whatever is just an annoying guy who won't leave you alone the entire time. And none of the characters seem to have any understanding of like what's going on in the greater world other than like what's 5 feet in front of them. And it's just so dumb and perfect, and it's like the Aloha forms Diglett's having those weird like
I'm sure that'll do well when Pokemon Stars comes out at the end of this year for the Switch. That might actually get Switch sales going. We just gotta get an image from Tom of I see this is Sam's right there. Sam's a
Before I forgot, I wanted to send it. I was hoping you would draw attention to it. But yeah.
Sorry, I'm drawing total attention to it. Anyways, sorry about that. This is just editing stuff. awesome list, guys. I mean, I think the 2016 ended up being a lot better than I thought it was going to. And I think part of that was, we had some games delayed and some games pushed out there. Like, I think a lot of us were hoping that things like Zelda and Mass Effect, Switch, other stuff was launching. Was launching in 2016, but we had a lot of great stuff, and it really made for a memorable year. I don't think it was the best year ever, but it was it's probably in the top, I would say top 5 years for me at least, of game content that came out that I enjoyed. I've played more games this year than I've played ever before. Part of that is because I was trying to go through my backlog of 52 games, which I will not get to, but we can get into a different time. But games from 2009 are great, I think it was an awesome year, and I'm really looking forward to 2017, the rest of this year, because just these first 3 months. I mean, we have Resident Evil is launching next week. I think that's mm-hmm. coming out. Obviously, you have Zelda, you have Mass Effect, you have Final Fantasy VII is supposedly coming out this year.
Yeah, game's never coming out.
Kingdom Hearts 3 is sometime. I don't know, who knows, but there are a lot of great.
Half-Life 3.
Yeah, there you go. Half-Life 3. Yeah. Beyond Good and Evil 2. There are a lot of great games coming out that we have a lot to be excited about. So thumbs up or thumbs down for 2016.
Thumbs up. Yeah, that was pretty good. Yeah.
Yep, enjoyable. Well, gentlemen, I want to thank you guys for joining me on this Sunday evening. I know it's Sunday night, but we felt it was worthy to chat about a couple subjects there, and I think we were able to knock them out of the park. So I appreciate the time that you three others have spent with me and all our wonderful viewers and listeners that joined us as well. You can find us at sidequesting.com. We'll be back at some point, maybe in the next week or two. We'll see. We're kind of figuring out our schedule again. We'll be at PAX East. We'll be all over the place. So stay tuned. And by the way, make sure you guys go out and read Wout's amazing first piece about Pokemon Go, which hits me because it's exactly the experience that I had. And I had something very similar happen to me in a park, but in my neighborhood. So very cool stuff. I highly recommend it. Where can we find you on the old Twitters and on social media?
On you can find me on at the hashtagonist, where the O is a zero in the end.
I will link it below. Like Perfect. And comment. Tom, where can they find you?
At that Tom Johnson.
At that Tom Johnson. Sam, where were they? If they were looking for you, where could they find you?
If you're the authorities, you can find me. At SamVI79 on Twitch. As I say every time, my annual tweet. This month's tweet, I don't think I've sent one, so zoom back in next episode and maybe I'll update you.
You can find me at Dolly Domofsky. You can find us at SideQuesting and SideQuesting.com, and we look forward to chatting with everybody again on The Side Quest. Bye-bye.